สวัสดีครับกสิทธิ์พิรมยา once again this time I will talk a bit on the Ukraine Russia crisis but before getting into the nitty gritty of things I just want to touch a bit on the present Thai political situation I just want to mention that with the closing of the parliamentary session for 2.5 months from the end of February to about the middle of May it provides the time for General Prayut Chan Ocha the Prime Minister to take stock of things and to I think recuperate and to reconsolidate his position to ensure that when the House of Representatives the Parliament in general opens again during the second half of May of this year he will have a majority in the Parliament and because we have to recall that the past 6-7 months and so on there have been defections from his party namely the Palang Pracharat and there have been much talks about the I think unviability and instability of the government of General Prayut Chan Ocha but lately for the past few days and so on I think things are turning for the better for General Prayut Chan Ocha in the sense that politicians started to realize that with the spirit and letters of the present constitution of Thailand it still means that the members of the Senate or the senators, 250 of them still have the right to vote for the Prime Minister. And since they were all being appointed by General Prayut, so it's very likely that the next time when the vote for the new Prime Minister come up, the 250 senators will vote for General Prayut. And General Prayut only needs about 120 seats inside the House of Representatives to add to the 250. You know, to gain the majority of the two cameras of the parliament to get at least 350 votes out of 750 votes around that time to get the majority and to be elected as Prime Minister of Thailand again. So with that realization by the politicians, so they said that if I want to be in the government, in the coalition government, then I would have to keep on supporting General Prayut. The thought of defecting to form new government and challenge General Prayut, I think has been subsiding. And with that, then it's a good news for General Prayut that he will be able to, I think, gather enough members of parliament in the House of Representatives. You know, to add to the 250 senators to ensure that he will be elected as the next top Prime Minister of Thailand or the third time Prime Minister of Thailand. So things are looking good a bit for General Prayut. And there, I think by implication, there will be more stability in the happenings of Thai politics. So let me leave that Thai politics here. But coming back to the Ukraine Russia crisis. I think the real crisis, okay, the real crisis from my own point of view and my understanding is the rivalry between the United States and the Russian Federation. Okay, for I think global supremacy in general, but I think at the global level, Russia is no match to the United States. Because Russia Federation's economy is too small to have any impact or influence on global economic financial activities and so on. But when it comes to military technology and the fact that Russia Federation possesses about 8,000 to 10,000 nuclear warhead missiles and so on, then it is a force to be reckoned with and it is more or less on parity with the United States. When you look into the numbers of submarines, aircraft carriers, and then nuclear warheads and so on, then I think the Russian Federation is second to none. So in that sense, it still has some sort of a power and influence in the world at large, and especially in the Middle East and in the European theater. But I think the thinking among the Americans all along was that it would like to be holding the primacy or the supreme power of the United States around the world. And the things that the Americans dislike most is for any one particular country to set up its own sphere of influence, you know, around its own country. For example, the Chinese would like to be the hegemon power and hold on to the sphere of influence around the western part of the Pacific Ocean, namely China Sea, South China Sea, and so on. Okay, that is the seas off the coast of China. But and there has been much exertion, assertiveness among the Chinese, but so far that assertiveness has been confronted with the, I think, not only the continued presence of the United States Seventh Fleet or military power, but I think the increasing coordination, alliance making, partnership between the United States and South Korea, Japan, Taiwan, the Philippines, Vietnam, Singapore, Australia, and most important of all, with India. So the United States lately has been able to line up democracies and friendly countries and so on, you know, in the sort of a containing of China in a defensive defense arrangement, military arrangement, and so on, so forth. So the United States has been quite successful in this, and I think it would become more successful even, you know, when all the various alliances and partnership get more coordinated. That's on the Asia-Pacific or on the Indo-Pacific theater. But when it comes to Europe and the Middle East, the Russians still has strong military presence in Syria. And it is a force to be reckoned with in the Middle East, including the, I think, how to handle both Israel and Iran. So it is an influential power, and it has a voice. And then when it comes to the, I think, the European theater, of course, it is the front door of the Russian Federation. And I think the Russian Federation, after it emerged as an independent country from the Soviet Union, the new Russian leadership from Yeltsin to Putin of today has come out with a principle of foreign policy and security policy called near abroad. What it means of near abroad is that Russia Federation doesn't want any other countries to threaten the security interests of Russia. And it would like to have the primacy or the sphere of influence or to be the hegemonic power, you know, at least in Eastern, Central, and Southern Europe, and in the Black Sea, in the southern part of both Ukraine and the Russian Federation. So by extension, with this near abroad policy, the Russian Federation also said that in that sense, it cannot accept the expansion or the enlargement of both the European Union and especially the NATO, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, because the European Union would have the full backing of the United States, while NATO, the United States, is, I think, the principal member of NATO. And for NATO expansion, it would mean the presence of United States military personnel and armaments and so on right at the very border of the Russian Federation would be, I think, in contravention to the near abroad policy of Russia to the security interests of Russia. That's why it came out very strongly and opposed the expansion of both the European Union and the NATO organization. And I think the prime mover, the supreme power inside NATO is the United States. So the expansion of NATO would mean the, I think, the extension and expansion of the United States influence into Eastern, Central and Southern Europe, which would be unacceptable to the Federation of Russia. And I think Russia has shown its discontentment, displeasure by, I think, attacking Ukraine, which it construed Ukraine as a proxy of the United States and members of NATO and the European Union. So it's a, that is a proxy war going on at the moment. So if it is only a proxy war, then I think the real rival parties should come to the negotiating table. So my point of view is that President Biden has to really think that to keep on pushing and punishing Putin, you know, from the, I think, various types of sanctions and so on top of providing military hardware and training the Ukraine military establishment, is that going to be up to the vital interests of the United States at the end of the day? Or is it, it would be better to recourse to the peaceful settlement of the whole thing through negotiations? And for this negotiation, I have a couple of words for your homework. One is the non-aggression pact. Okay. Second is the zone of neutrality. Third is the guarantee of sovereignty, guarantee of neutrality. Okay. Then enhancement of the partnership and cooperation between the NATO organization and the Russian Federation. So there are, I think, these words reflect that peace can be made if we negotiate on these various words that I have just mentioned. And then, but to do that, there must be a sort of a declaration of a ceasefire. And there should be a sort of the international peacekeeping. That is, once the ceasefire could occurs in Ukraine, then the United Nations could send peacekeeping forces to oversee the ceasefire and to keep the antagonist forces apart. And in that sense, then the question come to, then what can Thailand do? I think two things, which one, we could assist in the humanitarian assistance, which I think the Thailand permanent representative to the United Nations did mention that. Then the other point that I would like to suggest is for Thailand to join with other ASEAN member states in the UN peacekeeping forces for the Ukraine theater. Okay, so that could be the venue to get out of the Ukraine and Russian crisis. And let's tell all our respective governments that warmongering, crimes and punishment doesn't solve the problem. Everyone has to take a step back and come to the negotiating table for peaceful settlement. And no one needs to have the winner-take-all zero-sum game. I think politics is a game of compromise, of give and take, and of mutual accommodation. ขอบคุณมากครับ. Thank you very much.